show me some 40% body fat, $500 million guy, and I'll show you another dude that's probably miserable, that's masking all of his problems with more booze, more bullshit, more cars, more houses. Yeah. And then show me the dude that makes 75 grand a year, who's 12% body fat, who's got people that look up to him, who's happy as a clam sitting outside and fishing in a chair on the weekends. And I'll show you a dude that can live by himself, who's actually fulfilled and doesn't need anybody's affirmation.
Hello, Americans. It is with the utmost pride and sincerity that I present this recording as a living testament and recollection of history in the making during our generation.
Allow me to reintroduce myself. My name is Ho. H to the OV. I used to move snowflakes by the OZ. I guess even back then you can call me CEO or the ROC.
By the way, Aram, I just want to let you know, I started following you, and then I ran into your guys' podcast with you and Jimmy. And that is such an entertaining podcast, and I'm very happy to stumble upon that for sure.
Very happy to hear that, man. I hope you're getting something out of it.
Oh, dude, I'm getting a lot out of it. Not only am I getting the good knowledge that you guys put out, but the banter and the rapport that you guys have is a gift, I think, for everybody, for sure. So
we've been at it for a while now, so it keeps, you know, I teeter on the idea of like having it be more technically savvy.
Mm-hmm.
But I think he enjoys the entertainment aspect of it. I'm sure you've heard of Mind Pump before. I'm not a big fan of that format of like 45 minutes of drivel and then like 30 minutes of fitness and nutrition advice. So for me, like when I have guests on, I try to make it very like a little bit more like, how can we get the guest to really help the audience versus like, can we just break each other's balls for an hour? I don't know. I'm still kind of on the fence, like how I want to do it, because sometimes I have a lot of fun with it. And sometimes at the end of the hour, I'm trying to listen back to what we said, and I'm like, I don't think we fucking helped anybody.
Oh, man.
I don't know. So, you know, it's kind of like it's one of those conflicts that I have inside my head.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, I mean, that's how you know you care about your product is you ask that question every single time you get done with something, like, how can I be better? How can I be better? And I mean, if there's anything that I've learned, at least with my fitness journey, is that's the constant reevaluation of, hey, can I do this better? Can I do this better? Can I do this better? And so that's kind of how you know you care.
Sometimes we care too much.
Hey, you know what? But you care about how people show up in their lives from a health standpoint and all other aspects. So it's, I think it's important to care, because I don't feel like a lot of people care enough, you know?
You're right. I have to agree there.
No. And then also, you know, there's another thing that I've at least learned being in this space is, it's really imperative to speak in a manner that other people listen and pay attention, because, you know, I mean, how many times can we say, hey, work out, hey, eat better, hey, make better decisions? It's so fucking repetitive and redundant that sometimes you need a little bit of banter for people to pay attention still. You need a little bit of something for people to grasp the material. And, you know, maybe someone told me to eat less carbs my entire life, but if you're busting Jimmy's balls on there about eating more carbs or being a piece of shit, oh yeah, this is funny. Now, you know, and it's a lighter way of approaching the same thing, and it definitely enables people to make better decisions from a pure place and from a place of joy rather than a place of judgment or a negative space that most people are used to getting that information from.
Yeah, I mean, listen, I think if we're authentic and we're factual and we also talk about our own struggles as individuals, it becomes a little bit more of a message that can resonate with your average person, because I don't, you know, I walk around at probably 15% body fat all year round, and that's because I've spent 25 years of my life paying attention to this shit.
Yeah.
That's it. That's the only, and I don't have kids. My only responsibility is my dogs and my career, my business and my clients. Like, I don't, you know, I don't have all the same issues that other people have. So for me to tell Mr. and Mrs. Jones, who have two businesses and three children at home, that like they should be more compliant, like, I don't have the fucking right to say that. mm-hmm. because I don't live their life. I can give them the best practices and I can give them the tactics for them to be able to try to deploy them for themselves. But without that system of accountability and without that knowledge base, people just don't have enough skin in the game these days, and it's too easy to not comply.
And you know what? It's interesting because I was going to start asking you about this later on, but now that you bring it up, you know, the mindset, the applicability for you being in the line of work that you have been, where do you think that that's a huge challenge for people? Like, where do you think that, like you just said, everybody has a variation of different lifestyles. But in my opinion, I feel like there's, I hate to be like an asshole here, but I feel like it just, you got to kind of get it done. You got to be able to eat right. You got to be able to find a way to work out. You got to find to be able to make, get it done. So where do you think for you in your experience that people are challenged with that and they can't maintain those things?
I think it starts with having a very clear vision of what it is that the hell that you want. Like, what are you trying to actually achieve? Like, I think if you ask most people, like, I have clients that reach out to me or prospects that reach out to me on a weekly basis, almost on a daily basis. And I probably say no to working with people more often than I say yes, because not everybody's going to be a fit. And I know that some people just aren't prepared to do the stuff that I'm asking them to do, right? Like, a lot of people won't track their food. A lot of people won't prep their meals. A lot of people won't film themselves doing their exercises at the gym so I can give them feedback on it. So if you want to be that hands off with your own nutrition and training, I don't really have the answers for you. I can give you all the general basic bullshit advice that you've probably already heard 1,000 times, but you've already heard it. So mm-hmm. what is preventing you from knowing the information? Because the information is everywhere. It's not uncommon to see it now. I mean, there's plenty of great Instagram accounts that are handing out meal plans and recipe ideas and macro friendly this and training pro, and it's all free. But what is preventing, you know, Mr. and Mrs. Jones from complying to that stuff 90% of the time plus to get their outcome? And what is their actual desired outcome? Because if you're, you know, if you're a 350-pound guy or a 250-pound woman, anything you do is going to start to move the needle in the right direction. You start eating a little bit less frequently out or dining out less, you'll lose weight. You start walking more, you'll lose weight. You start sleeping better, you'll lose weight. But now when you start to get down into those nuanced areas of like, okay, let's now say there's a guy who's 200 pounds and he's already been kind of doing all this stuff for a while, or the woman who's 150 pounds and she's been at it for 5 or 6 years. How do you get them to start to understand, okay, where the hell do I want to go and how much do I actually want to dedicate my time and my energy to this specific pursuit? Because it is very sacrificial and it can become quite rigid at times. So it's, right. It's knowing, like, can we phase in and out of rigidity? Can we phase in and out of compliance? What are our baseline minimal standards that we want to hold ourselves to? So I ask a shit ton of questions before anybody is qualified to start to begin some type of a program, because I don't want people to set up for failure.
Right, right. Yeah. You know, I love that you're talking about this, because in my experience, so I was a huge transformation guy. I used to be an alcoholic. I you know, the 2 to 3 sentence self-description that you wrote, definitely I resonated with a lot of that, because you described yourself as a party boy at one point, and that was for me, you know. And I remember during those years looking at my body, wondering why the heck I'm not getting any kind of real results, and constantly chasing after this carrot that I was never going to get. And it wasn't until I realized, man, you know, the habits and behaviors that you have for yourself are not congruent with the results that you want, so you have to make a damn change. And for me, when I switched over to signing up for my very first competition, my very first bodybuilding competition, it taught me how to eat correctly. It taught me how to work out consistently. It taught me how to go after this higher version of myself that I never thought was possible. And those intrinsic qualities have now carried out in my everyday life. And that's how I've been able to maintain my body, maintain a baseline. Kind of like what you said, you know, 15% body fat for 25 years. And I feel like I'm on the pace for that. So I definitely, you know, when people ask me like, what is it that I do, or What do you recommend? I always say just, hey, sign up for a competition. Like, what? I can't do that. I can't do this. But, you know, kind of everything that we're talking about, by going after this competition, by default, you start learning how to eat right. You start learning how to work out consistently. You start, you know, and I think the most important part is nurturing yourself into a better version of yourself that wasn't possible. Because I the whole vision thing, I think, is 100% honestly the best approach, which is visualize yourself and actually go after what you want and be and do that with conviction, you know, because there's too many people that are like, hey, I want to lose 20 pounds. Like, oh, I want to lose. But I mean, what does that really mean? You know, what does that really say?
Well, there's a difference between desires and goals. You know, goals have actionable steps attached to them. Desires are pipe dreams. Mm. You know, I could say all I want about being the most successful fitness coach out there, helping thousands of people, you know, having my event turn into a 500 person event, but I have to have actionable steps behind those desires. So a lot of people say a lot of stuff out loud. And I think when you say it out loud, it starts to lose its power unless you do something about it. You know, I mean, I'm talking to adults every single day who are telling me how miserable they are, but then they continue to shoot themselves in the foot, my clients included. And, you know, I have no problem calling my clients out because I challenge every single one of them to get out of their own way. But I can't be the person who wants it for you because, again, it has to just be you getting up every day doing the mundane work, because fitness and nutrition are very mundane. I mean, you know, like, there's no sexiness in meal prepping. There's no sexiness in going to the gym. The outcomes can certainly be fun and sexy and enjoyable, but the pursuit of those things and then the maintenance of those things, which is even more boring. It's like, okay, cool. Now I've gotten to this place where I'm at 15%. Where the fuck do I go now? Like, I have to ask these questions to myself constantly. Like, how much more do I want to push compliance? Do I want to be 99% compliant? Do I want to be 100% compliant? Do I want to not ever eat out? Do I want to never not have a drink? Do I want to never not have a dessert or order something to my house? Like, no. So for me, it's like accepting that you could be okay with where you're at if you're truly happy with where you're at, because things outside of your physique or things outside of your material things are actually bringing you fulfillment and happiness. But not a lot of people are actually sitting down and having those thought-provoking internal monologue-based conversations with themselves. And not a lot of people are challenging to do so.
Wow. Yeah. You know, one of the more common questions I've always asked people when they're in pursuit of their goals, like kind of what you said, you know, like, I want to be 15% body fat, you know, then I'll ask them, like, well, is it about being 15% body fat, or is it about the lifestyle and the version of yourself that you're going to gain while being 15%? And then they're like, oh, that's where the light bulb hits. And then it's like, all right. And then also envision yourself in a 15% body fat and what that person is doing to maintain that. Are you doing the actions to maintain that 15% version of yourself? Like, oh, I'm not. Like, okay, well, then there you go. You're not congruent with exactly what you're saying, with the desires that you think that you want. And I think it's that lapse that definitely people are unfortunately comfortable in. They're comfortable with not actually going after what they want, even though it's a story that they tell themselves. And it's just an interesting effect that I see amongst people.
We have a high level of complacency happening in our society today. I mean, I grew up in a time, I'm almost 40. I'll be 40 next month. But immigrant background, came here with nothing. Watched my parents struggle my whole life. Watched people around me work multiple jobs to try to just, you know, put food on the table. And there was never any time to like complain about bullshit. It just wasn't. Like, my mother had cancer. She basically went to cancer treatment herself. Nobody in my family even knew about it because she didn't want to burden anybody with it. Like, that's where I'm from. So when I hear Mr. and Mrs. Jones complain about laundry, or I couldn't get to the grocery store when you have fucking Instacart on your phone, or, you know, I can't spend 40 minutes a day moving my body, it's like, what do you expect to happen then? Yeah. At some point, you have to be uncomfortable or have some tolerance for discomfort. You can't let every little problem in your life cripple you to the point where you can't act or move out of your own way. Like, you're a fucking adult with children And those children are watching you on a daily basis behave in the ways that you're behaving. And that's the lesson that you're leaving with them. Like, can you imagine, or I've always thought about this, like if my mother, instead of, you know, let's say like when she was diagnosed with cancer and she was, you know, on her way to the third job of the day, and if she just didn't go to work and quit because she couldn't handle it, or she stopped going to cancer treatment, she probably would have died. Or we would have never had enough money to pay the fucking bills in our house. So she didn't have a choice. The problem is today, people's backs aren't up against the wall. Like when you want to lose weight, like it's not that important to you, because if it was, you would move mountain, heavens and earth to do it. Right? Like it's you can verbalize it and say it to every friend at every cocktail party you go to. Oh man, I got to get rid of this, or I'm holding onto your belly. I got to get rid of this. That's great. But is it really that important to you? Like, is it actually a health problem? Is it just an aesthetic issue? Well, suck it up. You're just not prepared to do anything about it. If it's a health problem, when you went to your physician said, if you don't lower your blood glucose, if you don't lower your insulin numbers, if you don't lower your blood pressure in the next 6 months, you're going to highly impact the quality of your life. Are you prepared to live with that? So until it's a problem for many people, they just don't want to do it. Because again, like getting somebody to have four meals a day of about the same 15 or 20 foods, having somebody meal prep, having a morning and nighttime routine, purposefully getting 10 to 12,000 steps, going to the gym 3 to 4 days a week and actually knowing what the fuck you're doing in there versus being told what to do and then learning nothing. So all of these things are what I'm trying to empower people to do, because there's so many coaches in our space that are just handing out protocols and just sitting back and watching it happen. I want to understand the deeper rooted psychology of why you aren't able to do this stuff. And it's not just about the science, because the science is actually very simple and it's very easy. Like it's black and white. It hasn't changed in 1,000 years.
Right.
It just hasn't. I don't care what you say about biomechanics, about anatomy, physiology, biology. It's the same. What's happened is our environment has changed. So how do we get people to actually do all this stuff in this new and fucked up environment that we're in? Because we have options now, right? Like 100 years ago, you didn't have Instacart or Grubhub, or there wasn't a restaurant on every corner. There wasn't all this highly palatable, highly processed, cheap food everywhere. People were fucking walking all over the place. People liked moving around. Now it's like everybody's sedentary. Everybody's dying for dopamine and convenience. And that's why we're living in this bubble that nothing is just happening and everybody's standing still wondering why there's no progress being had.
Yeah. I definitely think it's crazy and scary, the complacent mindset that we're talking about, because it's so accepted among the norm that I definitely do think it's a big reason why people are being depressed, why people are fat as they've ever been, why people don't believe they can do anything about it. So it's lightning, you know, for people like you in the space to not only preach this message, but be the message that you're preaching. So what is it for you that gets you up to do a podcast about this, like 7:30 in the morning, that keeps you working out and eating consistently? Like, what is it for you? Like, what is your why, I would say?
Because if I don't, who else is going to? That's how I think about it. You know what I mean? Like, you ever seen any of the Equalizer movies with Denzel Washington?
I saw the very first one,
Okay. So there's a scene in the second one where he lives in this apartment complex in Boston, and they have like this, like community garden, and they have this very beautiful mural painted on a brick wall inside of the community center. And one day he wakes up and he's walking out to go to work, and the community garden's all ripped up and the mural's got graffiti all over it. So instead of going to work that day, he goes to the hardware store, he buys a bunch of paint, and he starts painting over the mural, he starts helping with the garden. And this, like, you know, kind of like hoodish kid that lives in the building was like, why are you doing this? He's like, because if I don't do it, who else is going to? So the way I always think about any type of meaningful change in our world is, if I don't start asking these questions, if I don't start pushing people in these directions, if I don't do it myself, then I lose the ability to be able to have any impact whatsoever. And if more people like me give up because they're frustrated, because our message isn't being received, then that message won't be anywhere at all to be found. So I think more of us have to understand that we have to say this shit constantly, day in and day out, nonstop, no matter whether we want to or not, whether we're tired or not, whether we're stressed out or not. And then at some point, maybe it resonates. And at some point, maybe somebody finally hears it and takes it into action. And then that will create a domino effect of change elsewhere, because everybody's watching. At some point, somebody's watching you, especially in today's age, whether it's on social media, whether it's because they've seen you do it in person. If you don't act in accordance with your values and your standards, then people are going to catch on to it. Just like if you do, they're going to catch on to it. And that stuff is infectious. I really do believe that change is infectious.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Yeah. I love what you're saying with you just don't know who's watching or who's anything. One of the guys that I'm working with now on my brand is a kid that I had worked with when I was still in the Navy and I was recruiting. I was recruiting my last 3 years in, and I was kind of mentoring him before he left for the Navy. And little did I know that he's been kind of watching me over the years. He saw how I went from a party boy to a transformation. Now I'm doing bodybuilding. And we reconnected over this last couple of years. He's like, dude, I've been watching you, blah, blah, blah. You've inspired me. You know, remember when you did this, this, and this? And you're like, holy crap, I had no idea. And now the impact that I see that I've made in his life and how we're working together has everything to do with how I showed up during the time that I had no idea anybody was paying attention. And it's, I learned that more now than anything else is if you don't embody the message that you're preaching, then everything that you say will just go on deaf ears. And it's almost like I don't want to say like you're a fraud, but it is almost like you're a fraud. It is almost like, you know, if I were to look for a diet plan or try to get advice on working out, like why would I look at someone who's a fat ass or someone who's just morbidly obese telling me how to be, you know, be healthy?
So well, I'll give you the devil's advocate side of that point. So let me rewind for a second where you were just saying integrity is what you do when nobody's watching. Right. Mm-hmm. Like that's the saying that we all have. Like I love that. I mean, integrity to me is one of the most important values that I have as a human being is what am I doing when there's nobody there to pat me on the back, when there's nobody there to praise me for my efforts? Like that to me is like being a really true badass individual. But what you were saying about not looking the part, what happens in the industry of fitness and nutrition, when you start to get to a place where you have such a high level of client load, you have all these projects you're working on, you know, let's say you're in your 40s, you do have a family, you do have a mortgage, you have all sorts of things that you're responsible for. There are a lot of trainers and coaches who do start to let themselves go a little bit. And mm-hmm. that's because aesthetics aren't their priority. Now, they're not like, you know, they haven't ballooned up to some stupid amount of weight, and they haven't completely let go of their habits. But let's just say they're not walking around dick skin lean all year long because that's just not their priority. Right. You know what I mean? So to me, when I see some shredded, crazy physique on Instagram, I have to start to ask, how much availability do you have in your life to be able to walk around like that? Like, do you actually have a ton of clients? Are you helping 70, 80 people on a weekly basis? Do you have a business model that's actually robust and doing well? Or are you just an influencer who just lives by taking more and more photographs of yourself half naked? And that's how you build credibility and clout versus actually having the scientific knowledge base and the human touch experience to be helping individuals. Because there's plenty of people that are fucking repped by Young LA or whatever, all these clothing brands that exist out there,
right,
that are just influencers. They have no knowledge base. They've done one or two bodybuilding shows. They were handed a fucking protocol. They were on gear. And okay, cool. Like anybody at 25 or 26 with nothing else going on in their life can get fucking 7% body fat. It's not that hard. Like just spend 16 weeks in a diet and you're good to go. But can you stay at 12 or 15% body fat while running a six-figure business, while helping 80 or 100 people, while constantly posting productive shit on Instagram versus just pictures of your back and your abs? Like that to me is somebody who's doing something for our industry. Like I am so anti-influencer. I'm so tired of the fucking coupon and affiliate codes and buy this and use this. Yeah. And, like, give out advice that actually fucking helps people. you deadlifting and curling in front of the mirror at the gym doesn't matter to fucking anybody that's watching. And all that's doing is telling the younger kids below you that are drooling over your bullshit that that's the way you should be. So all these kids that are in their, like, you know, late 20s, early 30s, who don't want to be professionals, they just want to be models, stay the fuck out of my industry. Like, you guys are the ones that are ruining this shit for me, because then I have to then dig these people out of the hole that you created for these individuals because you sold them the $4.99 a month program with no support, no education.
Yeah. No. I wonder, though, like, that's, but I feel like that impression that influencers leave, I feel like that is a lot of the beginning of a lot of people's journey as a general whole. You know, that they look at, oh, hey, this is the way that this image makes me feel is what I want to be and embody. And then I think that when you go into it and you pursue it from a very superficial entity, like we're speaking of, you start realizing it was never about the superficial entity, right? It was about actually doing the work, and beyond that is what actually gets you there. And I think sometimes failing is part of the process. And you know, it could definitely be beneficial on that, you know.
You have to fail. I mean, that's all it is. It's every week I'm figuring out another way to fuck something up.
Yeah.
I mean, yeah, honestly, whether it's with my business, whether it's with my nutrition, with my psychology, with the way that I'm able to communicate, like, I fuck something up on a weekly basis and I want to be called out. Like today, I reached back out to a client that I spoke, or a prospect that I spoke to on Thursday. And he was supposed to let me know on Friday whether or not he was going to go with me as a coach or whether he was going to go with somebody else as a coach. And I texted him this morning. I said, hey, man, well, you got any feedback for me? And he's like, yeah, I'm going to go with the other guy. I said, okay, cool. Can you tell me why so that I can understand and hopefully improve my service offering? He's like, it was honestly a toss-up, and it was just because he was able to show me certain forms and systems and blah, blah, blah. I'm like, all right, cool. So he's going to be what normal people in this industry are, which is a protocol pusher and just sitting behind an app. And when you actually have a question to answer or ask, good luck actually getting an answer from him. And I know what's going to happen. 3 or 4 months from now, that person's going to realize that the person they just hired is just giving them shit to do and not actually teaching them anything. And most of the time when people realize that they fucked up, they have too much pride in saying, hey, I was wrong and I made a mistake and I'm going to come back and work with you. So, and it's always funny to me because I lose more business than I get. And it's because I am the way that I am. Like, I'm not just going to work with anybody. I'm not at a place in my life where I'm fueled by scarcity. I know that I have plenty of people that will work with me if I just put out an offer tomorrow. I don't sell shit on Instagram constantly, so I know that I'm building up a bank of good grace. But there's a lot of coaches out there that are working with the idea that the reason why they're doing this is because of money. And this is not a money-based industry. Like, at the end of the day, this is a service industry. Like, we are servicing people. We are working with clients one-on-one and with some really dark and deep shit. Like, people eat like shit because they're not confident, because they have deeply rooted psychological problems. So some 26-year-old shredded fucking meathead or some 25-year-old booty model who's living in her parents' fucking basement on her mommy and daddy's dime doesn't know the first thing about hardship in this world.
Right.
So how is he or she going to be able to coach a 48-year-old menopausal woman who's got an eating disorder and has a shitty relationship with food? So this is not about science. And this is not about, like, macros and calories and reps and sets and time under tension and all this bullshit. It's about you knowing what you should do, but you're just not doing it. So we have to rip out of you what is the roadblock that you're standing in front of that you just keep ramming your head into for no specific reason. So we have to understand psychology, how it pertains to human behavior and change, and then start to apply physiology to that psychology. And that's when we start to get results. Like, you had a very specific why, right? Like, you got to a place where you're like, okay, cool, I'm done fucking pouring booze down my throat every weekend. I don't like the way I feel. I don't like the way it's making me look. It's making me unproductive. This stuff ain't going anywhere. I got to make a change or else I can't keep complaining about it. And you did. Most people are not wired like you. Most people are not wired like me. Like, if that was the case, then everybody in the world would be successful and everybody in the world would be in shape. But how many people are successful and how many people are in shape? You're talking about like 10% of a human population. or less that control the money and that have the health. So why is there such a big disconnect? It's because it's easier to do nothing than there is to do something.
True. True. Man, so with all this experience, and now that we're talking about, you know, the big whys of coaching and effective coaching and effective mentoring and just being there for one another, when did you realize that was the actual issue with people?
I mean, just watching people behave on a week to week basis, like when they're doing their check-ins with me and when I'm having the conversations on the phone with them, or I'm seeing what they write in their feedback forms, and I'm just realizing like something is going on. And if I don't ask deeper, meaningful questions, I'm never going to get to the bottom of this. And it's just going to keep being the same problem week after week after week. So the way that I structure my check-in process is I give people the option to have a phone call if they want. I don't have any, I mean, I have some people that aren't scheduled weekly phone calls, but I have most of my people basically just check a box saying, if you're not owed a phone call this week, would you like one? And on that phone call, what would you like to discuss? So what I end up doing is I end up kind of saying, okay, cool. That's been 3 weeks now. I've seen you not be able to hit your food. I haven't seen one workout video from you. You haven't showed up to one educational Zoom call that I've offered in the last month. So I'm going to proactively reach out to you and I'm going to get to the bottom of what the fuck is going on. And 9 out of 10 times, it's because people are succumbing to stress and not knowing how to deal with it effectively or productively. You know, kids are starting back up at school. Okay, yeah, that happens every fucking year. You don't have a process for that yet?
Right.
Work is really busy. That's it. That's how it should be. That means you're gainfully employed. You're welcome. Like, instead of looking at everything as a problem and a point of resistance, look at it as an opportunity to learn something about yourself and something about what you're doing to then improve. Because I think not a lot of people in today's day and age have a white belt mentality where they're willing to learn new information. And they hit this certain age where they're just like, okay, I'm 40. I'm done making any progress. Okay. I mean, you could do that, or you could be the 75-year-old who goes back to college and gets a fucking psychology degree. Or it could be the 80-year-old that goes and does their first bodybuilding competition. Right. But again, whenever you hear these stories of success, remember that they were preceded by years and years and years of failure. And remember that these are people that are not your average human being, because your average human being is not going to go to those lengths of self-development. They're going to sit in that same comfortable spot, because comfortable is what our brains are wired to want us to do. They are not meant, our brain doesn't want us to be challenged and stimulated and invigorated. Our brain wants to be like, cool, safe, comfortable, procreate, die. That's it. That's what the human physiology is set up for us to do. So if we don't manufacture discomfort, if we don't challenge belief systems and thinking, if we don't educate and then further educate some more and find deeper whys and deeper meanings, none of this stuff matters. Like, if you're only chasing money and that's why you work, you're going to hate your job. If you're only chasing aesthetics and that's why you eat well and train, you're going to fucking hate eating well and training. But if you like the way you feel internally because of the food you eat and the training you do, you'll probably stick to it forever. And if you enjoy showing up to work every day, it doesn't matter how much you'll get paid. You'll keep showing up. It's really that simple.
Yeah. Yeah. I want to take this back because to kind of what I should have asked you from the beginning, but we just got into a conversation like, oh, let's keep going. I swear, it's funny. I get in some of these podcasts where I'm just like, you know, I kind of want to know this guy's background, but then we immediately start talking about something. I'm just like, well, bam. All right, here we are. Right. You describe yourself as a corporate douche, quote unquote, and I'm paraphrasing, or I'm saying exactly what you told me. But you had a hard realization of material things not mattering, but rather the impact that you make in other people. And it's pretty evident that you've been talking about that. I was curious, was there a specific instance or moment that kind of sticks out to you where you kind of had that realization for yourself?
I mean, I wasn't fulfilled. Like, I was living a life that like other people would have looked at. Like, let's say, because like, was Instagram around back then? No, not yet. Like, I didn't get on Instagram until 2015. So most of my like shenanigans were on Facebook. That was back in the day of like the Facebook, you'd leave like your status on your wall and like that, you know, remember those days?
Yeah.
Like,
yeah, I did.
I was in finance. I was making, as a 20 something year old kid, I was making almost 100 grand a year, if not more some years, because of my bonus. I was surrounded by a ton of wealth. Kid, you know, guys in my industry were getting rich really fast because we were in commodities and there was no limitation on how much money you can make. I mean, we were trading oil, gas, and power. And in that time, I mean, the natural gas market was insane. You'd walk into the office and gas was trading at $2 a decatherm in the morning. And by noon, it was $15. And you were riding it all the way up. So you were just making money on top of money. And we had kids that were walking in 6 months into the career who were buying Aston Martins in cash.
Jeez.
And like, this is what I was surrounded by. And then now we're 45 minutes away from New York City. Now we're getting fucking blow FedEx to our office on an hourly basis and just going to do bumps of coke in the bathroom. Yeah. And this is what I saw. And I'm like, yeah. If I keep going down this road and I keep having all this fun and living this very materialistic, very shallow lifestyle, I'm A, probably going to spin myself off the planet mentally. Cause you know how it is, like when you party that hard.
Oh yeah.
The depression that follows the party is always so bad. And you're just always chasing that next high, that next party, because you're just so miserable in the times in between. So until I was able to like step back and remember what it felt like to just feel like a normal human being, I didn't really appreciate, you know, the quiet and stillness of life. I always needed to be stimulated. I always needed that next dopamine hit. And that's because I wasn't confident. I was still getting every ounce of my value from any woman that would talk to me or look my way. I was driven entirely by finance and money. And I realized that I wasn't good at what I did. Like, I just wasn't I wasn't good at finance. Like, I sucked at my job. I never asked for anything more. I didn't want to learn anything new. I was very complacent getting my paycheck because it was allowing me to fuel my behavior. And then when I got laid off in 2012, I had just like looked at myself and said, okay, cool. Something has to change. Like, I have to do something deeper and better and more than this. Everybody's been telling me that I should be a fitness professional. So I went and got certified through NASM. Within 3 months, I had my first gym job at an Equinox facility in Greenwich, Connecticut, which was like their flagship location, which was just basically just boku bucks, super rich people. Like, I mean, I'm talking more billionaires per capita than anywhere else in the world is where I was working. So like, there was no shortage of money. So, but again, I was walking into these people's houses and training them and talking to them like they were you or I, like they were just basically normal human beings. And they'd never been talked to that way before. So that's when I started to learn, like, I love what I do. I love challenging people. And I love finding out what they're capable of, because everybody's so stuck in their own like narrative that they tell themselves every day, that they never actually see outside of that, because nobody asked them to see outside of that. So I started asking these rich Greenwich housewives, like, are you happy? Do you like your life? Like, you're at brunch every day. You barely parent your kid. You're obsessed with how you look. You don't actually care how you feel. Is that how you want to live? And then all of a sudden it's like, no, not really. I'm like, so why do you keep doing it? You don't see your husband. Your husband's working 90 hours a week. He's probably fucking his secretary. Like, is this the life you want? Like, is it worth the money and the jewels and the house and the bullshit? And half the time they started to realize that they were miserable. And I realized very quickly that money doesn't bring you happiness. These people have more than enough of it. They could give it away by the drove and it wouldn't fucking matter to them. It was a gym that had a valet parking stand. Let's just put it that way. This is where I want. Like, it's ridiculous. Like, the amount of like supercars that were pulling up to the front of this thing every day, like there was either another Ferrari or a Lamborghini that they were driving up in. I'm like, and who cares? You're still a miserable human being. And you're still mentally and emotionally unhealthy. And you're void of any purpose in life. And that's what your kids are going to learn. So I'm just like, you know what? I don't need the fucking money. I had it and it didn't do anything for me. So now I'm just going to go on this relentless pursuit to help people and educate them. And hopefully, with that support and that education, they'll get out of their own way.
Yeah, man, that Wolf of Wall Street esque lifestyle that you kind of mentioned, it definitely, I feel like a lot of people are stuck into that, and that's what their goal is, to get into that constant chasing dopamine, chasing stimulation, chasing the next high. It seems like that's what people's goals are. these days? You know, like, how do I get into this where I just constantly get externally validated by a car or externally validated by women?
Do you think it's a goal, though, Alan? Do you think it's actually a goal, or do you think that they just don't know any better because they haven't thought any deeper? Because like, it's hard for me to think that that's an actual goal of somebody's.
Right. And I'm saying that I think it's a goal because I think a lot of people are chasing things on the surface, and it's not until you actually obtain that goal that you realize it was never about that goal. It was about what you think you're going to gain out of it. You know,
right.
I could definitely, man, because I have a lot of things in similar with you, my man. For me, my esque of what you're talking about is when I lived in Vegas and I pursued.
Oh, God.
See, there we go. Right. And the best of Coke, the best of other things are just there right at your hands. And the external validation of partying, going to these different clubs, you know, being around these certain women, I could definitely attest to the fact that if I were to look now back at that version of myself doing all that shit, I'm like, I was just not a confident person. I didn't know who I was. I wasn't solidified in action, having real goals. And I got effectively lost in the sauce. And that's kind of who I was. But furthermore, to add on to that, being in the poker world, I played with a lot of billionaires, millionaires, the biggest business people whose names I can't mention. And it was crazy to see that version of me, which is the chasing after the gratification, chasing after the women, chasing after, you know, the bigger things, except they're just more financially successful, but they're literally stuck in the same mindset. And you're right. It just, and for a lot of them, what I saw, at least, is that when you're challenging them on what they, you know, they realize they got to be healthier physically. They realize they got to actually do and make a change. But because they're so wired to comfort, their comfort is to, well, I know how to make more money, so I'm going to make more money and make more money and make more money. And it was, if it wasn't for poker, I wouldn't realize that money isn't the end all be all, because I saw people with all the money in the world still not fulfilled or gratified in anything that they're doing. And you know, I remember going, you know, after I was still play poker when I finally got into fitness and started taking care of myself. And I remember being like at a poker table with millionaires, and they're all, I don't want to say looking up to me, but having a high regard of respect just because I have a good physique and I was able to maintain, you know, being in better shape. And then it's like, kind of realize like, wait, if I want what they have and they want what I have, what is going on? You know, what is this really about? So
you can't buy the physique.
No.
Right. You can't. Like you walk into a room with broad shoulders and a big back and a lean waist, and you can say no to the booze and you can have the salad instead of the fried shrimp. That's a level of discipline that you can't purchase. And there are people that are walking around with pockets full of money that give in to every little temptation of life. It's not like once you're wired for money, it's not hard to keep making more of it. Just like if you're already on this path of fitness, it's not hard to keep going on it. Like you're just good at whatever you do normally. If that's your average behavior, then that's what you're just going to continue to do well at. But there's nothing to me, there's nothing more than like, there's no more pride that you can have and taking care of yourself physically and mentally. Like there's just so much to me, like show me some 40% body fat, $500 million guy, and I'll show you another dude that's probably miserable, that's masking all of his problems with more booze, more bullshit, more cars, more houses. Yeah. And then show me the dude that makes 75 grand a year, who's 12% body fat, who's got people that look up to him, who's happy as a clam sitting outside and fishing in a chair on the weekends, you know, or going for 3-mile walks with his dogs in the mountains. And I'll show you a dude that can live by himself, who's actually fulfilled and doesn't need anybody's affirmation.
Yeah. Now we're on this topic. What do you think it takes for people to reach that about themselves?
Feel what it feels like to not have it. And just like actually like, and also like stop and think every once in a while, like sit in some silence, take yourself out of the noise, take yourself out of the rat race, spend time alone. You know, I was so codependent my whole life. Like, if I wasn't with a girl or wasn't dating or wasn't fucking somebody, like, I was always miserable. Oh, yeah. Like, there's no girl that's hitting me up on text message. I must be a loser. Or, I don't have a date coming up this week. What's wrong with me? And then I spent, like, 3 years, like, actually purposefully single with a couple of flings in between just because, you know, we do have desires and wants and needs, and those things have to be fulfilled. So, whatever.
I get it.
We had to scratch that itch a couple of times. But, like, in general, like, I traveled by myself. I drove cross country by myself. I did all sorts of shit by myself. I would go out on the weekends by myself. I would sit at a bar by myself. I would go to a restaurant by myself. I wouldn't go out at all and just sit at my house by myself with my dog. And that was when, like, all of the stuff started to really happen for me. That's when I started, my energy changed. The people that started showing up in my life started to become more higher quality. What I demanded of myself was more high quality. So that just all started to bleed into every interaction I had. And all of a sudden, that's when I found out, like, self-awareness and introspective thinking and stillness and calmness is what most people are missing. And if you just spend some time getting, like, okay with being bored, you know, and not being stimulated by something that's just completely, like, having to nail you in the face so you can actually do something. That's right. When I started to really, like, understand myself. Like, that's when I became a man. I was just a little boy running around finding the next toy for so long. And I think it really wasn't until my mid-30s until this shit changed for me. And that was because I had lost and I had gotten and I had lost again and I was down and I was up and I had spent time wondering why it was all happening. But yeah, it was really just that kind of that 3 year period where I spent by myself and doing stuff by myself and being okay being by myself where my entire life turned around. And by the way, man, don't think that I'm like, I don't battle with any of this stuff still, that there's still not times where I want to fucking throw a bag of blow down my nose or I don't want to go to that Vegas. I don't want to go to that Vegas pool party or I don't want more money or I don't want, you know, the attention of some girl. Like, that stuff is never going to go away. It's still going to be there. It's just not here. It's not in the forefront of my head now. Now it's background noise for when, because there's so much stuff floating around now that's important to me now in my immediate, you know, stratosphere that takes up my attention, that stuff doesn't matter as much. But every once in a while, I'll be scrolling through my phone on a Friday night when I'm sitting on my couch watching TV and I'll see people party. I'm in San Diego, so, like, I can go. I mean, every fucking DJ in the world comes here every weekend. Like, last weekend, it was Dylan Francis, Diplo, Afro. Like, everybody was here. Everybody was out. I was in bed by 8:30 on New Year's Eve. Like, I've done it already. I've gone to the clubs. I've been to Live. I've been to Space. I've been to fucking One Oak. I've been to the pool parties in Vegas. What else is there to do, to say, and to experience? Like, every once in a while, sure, once every 3 or 4 months, I'll still go out. I'll still go and indulge and do that stuff and just turn my brain completely off and do recreational drugs and be an idiot. But most of the time, my life is pretty straight and narrow and forward. I'm paying attention to my business. I'm paying attention to my mental and physical health. I'm nurturing the relationships that are around me, and that's it.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, so I was stationed in San Diego, so I remember the years of partying in Gas Lamp as well as partying in PB. I remember there was a time period for me where I couldn't identify Gas Lamp during the daytime, but if you were to take me during the nighttime, I could show you everything of where the hell everything was, you know, like the back in the Stingery days, back in, when Flux wasn't so, what it is now. I don't know if Flux even exists anymore.
I don't think so. No, there's, if that's what turned into Omni and now that's called Nova.
Oh yeah, yeah. There was Stingery. I think Stingery turned into Omnia because I remember there's a funny instance. Apparently, when Stingery was still Stingery, there was a guy that drove his car into that club, and they had to restructure that into Omnia or something like that. But that was go a little off topic. But I remember that. Like, huh, that's interesting. What was that guy was thinking?
But the thing is, like, it's fun. It's fun to relive these stories. Like, I think it's like sometimes we look down on this stuff, but every once in a while, like, understand it was a part of who you were. Mm-hmm. You can't regret it. You can't beat yourself up over it. It's not your identity, but it's a part of what made you who you are today. Like, I'll never regret the drugs that I did or the money that I spent or the nights I spent fucking miserable out until 7 in the morning wondering why the hell I'm still alive. Like that stuff is all monumental into that self-development process of realizing right. what you actually want, because you got to weed all that stuff out. Like life is just one long journey where you're just kind of like pushing stuff out of the way, trying to get to where you're going. That's all it is. And then eventually like you get there and like the grass opens up and it's green and there's blue skies and you're like, okay, I'm here. Now what?
Right. Yeah. There's not a moment that I regret any of those instances, just like what you said, because of what I've been able to learn from it and how I perceive life now, and now how I can help and support people that are kind of stuck into that lapse of that lifestyle, you know, and especially being in like San Diego. Like, so I went from Gaslamp San Diego to Las Vegas. Like there was no drop off by any way, shape or form. I look back at everything and I'm like, how did you live, Alan? I have no, honestly, I was just talking to one of my buddies about this. Like if it wasn't for the three deployments that I did that literally forced my body to stop, I don't know what would have happened to me, you know, but there's also something to be said about if I wasn't getting deployed, I probably wouldn't have gone so ham. So, I mean, who knows, you know? But I think you hit it on the head where you're saying that those desires are still right here, right? I mean, let's be realistic. You know, I don't exactly would never condone doing cocaine or doing anything like that, doing any blow, but man, I've had some good times. I'm not going to lie. I've had some great, I've connected with a lot of people over it. And built some relationships, to be honest. But you know, in my opinion now, for me, it's not exactly pushing those desires away, but acknowledging that they exist and acknowledging that they happen and getting used to, you know, being comfortable with being uncomfortable, as they say. And it's by constantly just doing that. And I think for me now, a lot of my willpower, a lot of my strength comes from just identifying that it happens, but just not giving in.
Yeah.
You know, like, you know, if I don't drink very much at all, and if at all ever now. But it's, you know, every time I have a drink, you know, you get that internal urge to, you know, like what we're talking about, because, you know, I'm there's a wire in me that still says, hey, every time you drink, like, here we go, what are we going to go find some other party and got to find this, that, and the other. Then, you know, the me now, you know, now that I'm on this end of it, I'm like, no, Alan, yes, that's there. It's okay. But you have the option to not give in, not have to do that. And it's by constantly, in my opinion, choosing that on a regular basis is where you start developing that willpower and ultimately start developing confidence in everything that you're really trying to do and really think that matter. So
that's the thing. That's a perfectly said. Like it's the more repetition you have saying no or saying yes, whatever it is, whatever the pursuit is, the more confidence you're going to build doing it. I think the reality when it comes to, let's say, just fat loss, people just don't have the systems in place that they're confident with. And they've failed so many times because they've had the wrong approach that they have no confidence in trying again. So when you tell them a reasonable set of advice, like, you know, don't eat less, eat better. Don't train more, train harder. Don't, you know, have a morning time and bedtime routine that you can really rely on. Like, until people actually do those things for a length, and I mean like 6 months to a year. I don't mean like 3 to 4 weeks and this didn't work. With nutrition, any change you make to nutrition, 30 days of consistency, at least. That's my advice to anybody. With training, don't change any workout until you've done it for 8 to 12 weeks and you've been able to progress and you've potentially stalled out on some things. Then maybe explore a change. But people are like just jumping in and out of diets. They're jumping in and out of weight of strength training programs. They're going in and out of different group fitness classes because they just want to be told what to do. Until you actually take a vested interest in this stuff on your own and have this stuff become cemented into your routine, it will never work. It won't. Right. It just won't. And I'm sorry to say that it just won't work because it's not a part of who you are. It's not your identity. Like I don't have to convince anybody that I'm a fit person. I walk into any room and there's no confusion. The way I order at a restaurant leaves no confusion. The way I show up at the grocery store leaves no confusion. Like everything in my life is centered around me making decisions about my health and well-being. Everything else is secondary. It really is. Like it's one of my top three priorities every day. I know when I'm going to eat. I know when I'm going to train and what I'm going to do at the gym. and I know what I have what my responsibilities are for the day with work. That's it. Like, that's right. Really all. I mean, obviously, like, my dogs have to get fed and all that shit. Bills have to be paid. But, like, if fitness and nutrition are not part of your top three or four priorities on a daily basis, they will not become sustainable for you to actually get the results you want.
Right. Right. Yeah. And that's another thing about fitness and nutrition, especially for me now. Like, I, you know, doing competitions, there's definitely, when you get done with the competition, there's that little drop off, you know, there's that little, like, hey, we got to take some relax. But, you know, in my experience, every single time I've got into that relaxed mindset and started not eating as astringent or not working out as much, I feel so damn different. And I feel like, holy shit, this is, and that's why I was on a recent podcast and someone asked me about how, you know, how do I take my competition lifestyle and how do I play it out into my regular life? And I really told them it hasn't changed. It hasn't changed at all, because I know that as long as I'm eating right and I'm working out correctly, that it literally affects how I show up in my everyday life. So I, you know, if I want to be the best boyfriend to my girlfriend, I have to eat and train right, because it lets me show up cognitively, lets me show up and be you know, witty and funny and the things that she enjoys about me, you know. For my daughters, you know, in order for me to be confident and have a, you know, a big father figure for them, they're like, oh, hey, dad needs to, you know, be like this. I know that it requires me to eat and train a certain way because it's my overall confidence and it contributes to who I am as a person. And so I love that you're saying that, because what we eat, how we train, isn't just a matter of aesthetics, but it's about how we feel and how that feeling ultimately shows up in our everyday lives. And yeah, man. Yeah, man. I wanted to last ask you about this and, just kind of, you know, give an opportunity to talk about it. Cause you keep on talking about your coaches summit, that you have that going on in Vegas. I think that's a phenomenal opportunity. I'm really curious about it. And for anybody else who is a coach or anybody that's listened to this long, I definitely want them the opportunity to know about what's going on with that.
Yeah. So I created it last year just due to the frustration that I had with so many of the fitness and nutrition events that I was going to on a yearly basis. I come from like the old school of like going to conferences and connecting and networking and learning. I think that's starting to become a little bit less prevalent, because I think now with the advent of the online space, people are just kind of relegated to their computer at home and they don't really branch out much. So they don't really see what's going on in the industry. But I think this is a, you know, events are a great way to connect to other business professionals that are doing what you do. It's a great way to just meet other people that are on the same path and on the same journey as you are. And, you know, 99 out of 100 times, yeah, the information on stage that's being presented is relatively valuable. I mean, with my event, I think more so practical and tactical than other events I've been to, because I've wanted it to be that way. But it's the conversations you have, you know, in between sessions, in the hallways, at the happy hours, at the dinner. So with my event, knowing that that's the key to connectivity, all your food and all your booze is included. So, you know, the ticket right now is $9.98. And I mean, you lived in Vegas. To spend 2.5 days in Vegas and eat gourmet food and drink 6 hours of open bar happy hour, that would probably cost you $1,000.
Oh, yeah, easily.
So, I mean, remove the education piece and just to go and show up and have fun, it's already worth $1,000. And, you know, there's a bunch of coupon codes flying around for the event right now anyway, so you can probably save more than that. But let's say you spend $1,000 to come to this event. You're going to leave your wallet in the room. You're going to have, what, 14 speakers speaking over the course of 2 days on a myriad of topics, from mindset to nutrition optimization to fitness and training programming. You're going to have 3 meals a day that are catered to you, where you get to actually sit with all the attendees and the speakers, because the speakers don't just run away. Because a lot of events you go to, you'll get some like keynote speaker who comes up there and like ramps you up, and then they're nowhere to be found. You can't talk to them. You can't pick their brain. They're gone.
Right.
I don't pay any of my speakers. So to me, it's like, I'll give you a hotel room. Just show up and do your thing, because I want you to actually give back to this industry. So for me, it's kind of a philanthropic thing. I don't monetize it. So like, I mean, I fucking lost $30,000 on it in 2023.
Jeez.
This year, I'm tracking to hopefully at least cover my expenses. But like, I don't want it to be a money-making endeavor for me. I'm just trying to give back to this industry. I'm trying to get coaches and enthusiasts to be in a room with credible, experienced information and education, as opposed to just motivation. Because, you know, I'm sure you've been to conferences where, like, you know, somebody who's made $8 million or somebody who's lost 100 pounds is on stage talking, but they don't say anything.
Right.
They're just talking at you, and then they get off stage, and you're all fired up, and then you leave, and then on Thursday morning when your fucking kid wakes up sick and throws up on you and life sucks, you're like, I lost all that motivation. It's gone. So with my event, I want it to be like, I told all my presenters, I'm like, I want this to be tactical. I want people to be able to walk away from the session that they listen in on you with that day, that they can immediately apply the information to themselves, to their business, to their coaching, and get immediately better at it and have more confidence as a coach or as an individual. That's what it's about for me. Like I handpick every single speaker. I was asked by multiple people to get on stage and I'm like, I don't know who the fuck you are or what you're doing. So no way. Yeah. You know, it's just, it's a very grassroots organic effort. And I think for anybody that's either a fitness or nutrition enthusiast, coach, physical therapist, doctor, anybody in the health and wellness space, it's a must because A, you're going to get education, but the people that you'll meet in that room, like last year, there were so many people that showed up and they just left as friends. And now they're doing podcasts together. A couple of people are writing books together. A few people have started coaching as a conglomerate of coaching practices together. So I'm trying to be the catalyst for that improvement of our industry because I think that the industry has gone in the wrong direction and I'm trying to reel it back in.
Yeah. Yeah. And, you know, for me, what I would value more than anything else is the opportunity to network and,
yeah,
you know, be around that synergy of great like-minded people who are always about trying to improve everybody else. And that service mindset is just so priceless. So priceless. All right, Aram.
Are you in Vegas still or no?
No. I'm actually in the Inland Empire. So I'm near my parents and my kids. I can't do that anymore. I want it now, mind you. I want to go back to Vegas because now I realize the business opportunities that are there, especially to what I do now. As well as the networking that I had. Cause when I was there, there was never a moment where I didn't have someone that I knew from high school or knew from college or knew from, the Navy or anything else that just happened to show up. And I was like, oh, I get to show them kind of thing. So it's a real central hub for people to reconnect. But you know, but I would like to do that now, not the version of myself that was there that, like we said earlier, well, man, that's a, yeah.
Get your ass out there in March. We'll connect.
Yeah, absolutely, man. I'm definitely very much interested. For everybody else who's been followed up, your Instagram, any way that they can reach you, how would they be able to reach you, man?
Just 4 weeks to the beach on Instagram is my handle. I'll answer every DM. It's the number 4 and the number 2 weeks to the beach. And then the event website is realcoachessummit2023.com. So if you want details or information, either they can reach out to me or you can send them my way or whatever. But I talk about it every day or every week on my stories and stuff. So, but yeah, if there's ever any questions that anybody has, I'm not a salesperson. I'll just help you. I don't really give a shit about the money. So ask me whatever you want. The event is something that I do have minimum standards on. So like I can't go below a certain price because I just have to make my money back. The fucking event's $150,000. It's stupid. The amount of money that they charge to do events and things, but it is a very first class event. Like it's not like, you know, it's not like sandwiches for lunch. Like you sit down and it's like flank steak with salad and you know, it's unbelievable. So like I have to, like last year I was giving tickets away. This year I'm like $548 cheapest I can go. I'm sorry.
Right.
Like if you can't afford that, you don't have to be there.
Right. Right. And that's the thing too, is you have to have a certain minimum price for people to actually invest themselves into it and take it seriously. Like, you know, if there's one thing I've learned in this space, you can't just give things for free because people won't value it. You know, it's just the reality of what it is. You got to put a little bit of grit in the game. And then also I can definitely attest to, Aram's, not want to say ability, but his consistency of replying to DMs. And his entire Instagram is very entertaining. He has a lot of great messages. On top of the delivery of your messages is pretty hilarious. So for anybody that wants to get a lot of great advice and laugh along the way, it's definitely 4 weeks to the beach for sure. So yeah, Aram, thank you very much for this. Stay on for just a little bit after hit stop record. For everybody else who's been paying attention, thank you all very much. And I hope you have a very blessed week.
Appreciate you having me, man. Ew.
Allow me to reintroduce myself. My name is Ho, Ho, H to the O-V. I used to move snowflakes by the O-Z. I guess even back then you can call me CEO